Hi, everyone, and thank you very much for joining. So of all the books I have read related to politics, if I had to choose, not which is the one that I consider the most correct, so to speak, the one that better captures political philosophy the way I see it. But if I had to choose one that had the biggest impact on me, and if I would choose one thinker in terms of, if you have 30 minutes with people, let's say I enter in a class and I have one go. I cannot give them a full philosophy, but I have one go at giving them a good food for thought about the defense of liberty. This would be this book. This is Robert Nozick's Anarchy, State, and Utopia. This is a book that came out in 1974, and it won awards. It made a huge impact at that time. And it is considered the opposite pole from Rawls. So usually you will see it brought into discussions about inequality or about defenses of freedom. Now, obviously, what I'm going to say today is not an endorsement of everything in Nozick, but we're going to discuss with Jonathan, who is kind enough to join us once more. Thank you, Jonathan.
Great to be with you. Thanks, Nikos.
Thank you. We're going to discuss the good and the bad things in Anarchy, State, and Utopia. Now, another thing about Nozick. Nozick is not a lifelong, let's say, political philosopher in terms of sticking with the same topic. We could say that Anarchy, State, and Utopia was a one-hit wonder. So Nozick, at some point, gets interested in the ideas of freedom, gets interested in what we'd call libertarianism, and this interest allegedly has to do with him meeting Rothbard, although the two of them did not have a good relationship. So he says, okay, this is an endeavor I want to jump in. He jumps in with this book. Later in his life, he deviates from these thoughts. He jumps into other endeavors. So we're going to discuss mostly the book rather than the man himself. So again, Rod Nozick was very prominent academic at Harvard, unfortunately died relatively early, I think in 2002. So let's jump in it. The book has three parts. And the first part is an explanation of how you can reach a government without violating anyone's rights. So he begins in the preface by saying, individuals have rights and there are things no person or group may do to them without violating their rights. So you see this initially, you give a thumbs up. And then he says, our main conclusions about the state are that a minimal state limited to the narrow functions of protection against force, theft, fraud, enforcement of contracts, and so on, is justified. So the minimal state is justified, continuing the quote, that any more extensive state will violate persons' rights not to be forced to do certain things and is unjustified, and that the minimal state is inspiring as well as right. So if you read these lines, you realize that why so many people are confusing the ideas of Nozick, maybe understandably, with the ideas of Ayn Rand. And yet we will see how someone can have some very, 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 very good ideas, but if they're not based on the proper foundation, and unfortunately, in my opinion, Nozick's ideas are not based on the proper foundation, there you can be right for the wrong reasons. And this is what we'll see happening with Nozick. So what does Nozick do in the first part of the book? He says, look, imagine we're in a state of nature. Imagine we're in a state of anarchy. And he says, I'm going to show you, I'm going to prove you, I'm going to deductively explain to you how you can go from a state of nature to a situation where you have a government and this government has a monopoly of force and this government does not violate your right. Now, this is an interesting thought experiment because he, first of all, he realizes that even if no actual state ever arose that way, so he says, I'm going to make a thought experiment about how you could have a legitimate government that does not violate your rights, although it has never happened. So this is a weird way to begin establishing the legitimacy of a government that does not violate its people's rights. But maybe because, again, what triggered his interest was his contact with anarchists like Rothbard, or who knows what, he begins from that point of view. And here is the big first difference.
Let me ask you, can I ask you a quick question, Nikos, just to jump in here really briefly. Isn't that oftentimes, you know, one of a common objectivist objection to anarchism is that they start with politics, right? It's all through politics from their perspective. You know, Rand starts with, you know, what is the nature of man? So isn't that, you know, kind of, even it sounds like with Nozick, who, you know, pre-show the Lord Emperor had to remind me that it's not Nozick. I've never read this. So, you know, you're teaching us all something here today. Isn't that kind of indicative of libertarianism, that for them, politics is everything. It's all based on politics.
Yes. So you hit something you mentioned something very important. Nozick begins with morality. So he says, look, we recognize the rights, but he doesn't go deep into why we have rights. And he recognizes it. He says, look, that's a too big of an endeavor. And the best justification he can give for rights is, well, we can all agree that rape and murder and stuff is not good. Or he uses Kant. He used the idea that people are not to be used as means towards ends. So Nozick is way less systematic than Rand. Nozick begins with the assumption that we all agree that we have rights. But turns out we do not all agree that we have rights. You have people that say that no, rights is a way that the rich take advantage of the poor. Others say no, might makes right. Others say no, there are different rights for you need affirmative action. So objective rights, neutral rights is a racist thing. So you have all sorts of disagreements on what rights are. So Nozick, maybe thinking out of a good consciousness, says, okay, we can all agree that we have rights, but this is not the case. So what he says is, look, what would happen is you would end up people budding up together to protect their rights, and you would end up with different associations for protecting rights. And again, this is a huge logical leap, because what if these are not associations for protective rights? So for example, me, Razi, and Jonathan, we hire Mark Pellegrino and Raka to protect our rights. And other people hire
Mark and Raka? I'm gonna want to get someone a little more trained, certainly, than Raka. And
well, we don't
Mark
know.
Well.
Maybe he has talents that we are not aware of. So Nozick's assumption is that these are going to be associations that will want to maintain the peace. And the point, there will be problems. So for example, what if one association of protection disagrees with another association of protection? But he says, and I'm jumping through, I mean, this is the whole first part of the book, says at the very end of the day, what's going to end up with is you're going to end up with one association that is going to have something like a monopoly of force. However, he says, I recognize that if you don't want to submit yourself to that association, you have a right not to do so. Or what if you are poor and you cannot pay that association? Then this association is not a state, because if you don't pay them, they don't protect you. And then again, Nozick goes on very, very elaborate mental gymnastics and says that no, at the end of the day, it is their interest to also protect you who have not paid them. Or let's say Jean-Claude Van Damme, or he used, I think, the example of John Wayne, let's say the tough guy who can protect himself. So even that person, he is under the monopoly of that force, because otherwise, if he goes his own way, then it is there's this conflict, because he goes against someone who is under their protection. So he goes through a very rationalistic scheme to explain how you end up with a government. What does Rand do? Rand says, no, you, sir, again, I'm paraphrasing, you basically made a mental experiment on how an invisible hand would create a government. What Rand says, this is not how governments are created. Governments are created when people have understood the notion of individual rights. They have understood it in terms of they have morally understood that people need rights. And then they come together in a society, they've understood that coming together in a society is beneficial. And then this society needs to recognize this. And thus, these people establish a government. Now, to be very
can I just jump in briefly? I mean, I've always liked Dr. Brooks' comment that objectivism sees government as a necessary good. You know, I mean, the anarchists, there's always this kind of fantasy, hey, if everyone was just armed, you know, that might be true. But I've always appreciated, again, kind of quoting from objectivist jargon, if you will, that government has that monopoly over the use of force so that we don't have to have these competing cartels of who's going to be the real peacemaker, how we decide by fighting it out in the street. And Rand and Dr. Binswanger and so many of the objectivist objections to anarchism, I think, are so spot on and are in my mind, at least, addressing a lot of what your Nozick is proposing.
Careful, though. Nozick is not a proponent of anarchy. Nozick, though, tries to prove mostly, God knows why, to the anarchists, why you, from anarchy, an invisible hand is going to lead to a government that does not violate anyone's rights. So this
saying, it's not an invisible hand. It's the hand of all these factions fighting it out in the streets. You might say, it's invisible. But when you don't have a monopoly over the use, that is what government is, right? From the objectivist perspective, it has a monopoly over the use of force, strictly delimited. But when anyone's going to decide what are rights, well, this one says this is rights and that one says that is rights. So the invisible hand, where's the invisible hand? It's people fighting it out in the streets. Am I imagining that?
No, you're right. So Rand believes that it has to be a conscious decision that we need a government because that's the way to go through life if you want to live with other human beings and enjoy the benefits. Now, part two is Nozick at his best. So this was the bad Nozick. Nozick not really setting a frame for individual rights, and Nozick doing this, I would say, not based on, rationalistic thought experiment on coming up with a state that somehow is not going to violate your rights. So part two, though, is the really, really good part. And this is where Nozick talks about his theory of distributive justice. And this is Nozick at his best. So Nozick says, how do people nowadays view the issue of justice? Whether, for example, it is just and fair that some people have a lot and some people do not have a lot. He says the way they do it is they check the current moment. And the current moment says, Jonathan Hoenig, you have a lot of money.
Oh, not that much, really. No, just a couple of bucks. And I said, no, I don't really have that much.
So they say, look.
You must have me confused with someone else.
The capitalist speak has a lot of money, and the poor guy down the corner has not got a lot of money. So Nozick says this is not the right question. The right question is not to look at the moment in time and says this person has X, this person has Z. Nozick says the question is how did you get it? And he says there are three ways that you can actually get it, which is, you acquire something because you created, let's say, from scratch, or someone gives it to you via voluntary transaction, or third, you are compensated for something that has been a wrongdoing in the past. So he says, whatever arises from a just situation by just steps is itself just. This means, Jonathan, let's say you're father or your grandfather did not steal any piece of land, so the land you have, you own it. Then you work in your life, and now through your work, through your mind, you have a lot of money. Through voluntary transactions, you haven't harmed anyone. Then thumbs up. Doesn't matter if you have way more money than anyone else. The fact that we trace back the steps, and this is through production or voluntary transaction, means that you are entitled to your wealth.
Let me ask you, is that basically kind of a tacit defense of property rights?
Yes, but now he mostly starts addressing, he has started addressing the socialist, and he has started addressing roles in the center right, center left, who believe that there should be a redistribution. So he says that the holdings of a person are just if he's entitled to them by the principle of justice in acquisition and transfer, or by the principle of rectification of injustice. He says this, and of course we can understand that he understands property rights, and he believes that if you got it in a right way, then... And he says there are various ways to redistribute from each according to his ability, to each according to his religion, the greatest good for the greatest people. He says, take all this aside. There's one just principle, he says, and that principle is from each as they choose to each as they're chosen. And then he goes to his immortal, brilliant thought experiment. So Nozick is some of his thought experiments, as I said, are not so good, but some are so good in concretizing principles. That's why I said that if you put me in a class and I have 30 minutes with students to persuade them about the value of freedom, I will use Nozick, because he's not as systematic, obviously, as Rand. His defense of capitalism is not as principled as capitalism. They are non-ideal, but his concretizations are so good and powerful that they can have a quick impact. Of course, this impact is going to be forgotten if you don't systematically support it, but I want to bring this example. So he uses Will Chamberlain, but I will use Adele. We all know Adele, the brilliant singer. He says, look, imagine there's an equal village. Everyone has exactly the same, £10, $10. And then Adele shows up to that village for a concert. Voluntarily, 10 villagers go to the concert, and the price is £1 for the ticket. Now, when you had 5 minutes ago, you had an equal village. Now, five people are £1 poorer, and Adele is £5 richer. And Nozick asks, has there been an injustice here? Do we need to redistribute somehow the fact that Adele has that money? In the book, he uses Will Chamberlain, but maybe many millennials will not know him. That's why I used Adele. So with this sort of experiment, Nozick says, look, again, there might be a big inequality. And this is what Yaron Brook says. Yaron says, every time you buy a book by J.K. Rowling, you make inequality, quote, worse. But actually, this is not true, because you are better off. You bought the book. J.K. Rowling is better off. She's richer. But you both won. And this is what Nozick says with the Will Chamberlain example. So his point is the socialist society, so a society that would intervene in this process, the society would say, no, we have to redistribute, going back to the quote. The socialist society would have to forbid capitalist acts between consenting adults. And how nice is this? Capitalist acts between consenting adults. And here's something that I cannot understand. We all agree in society that using coercion in the bedroom is wrong. It's reprehensible. It has to be punished. Why, though, does society consider that using coercion when it involves many people and somehow democratically decided, as, for example, with taxation, suddenly it's okay? So Nozick says, no, consenting acts between capitalist acts, he means where there's money involved, between consenting adults, they who should have the same sanctity, the same moral status as any act between two or more consenting adults. And we know that if that act is uncoerced, is both are voluntarily agreed, it is to be respected. If there is coercion involved, then coercion is bad. So that, I think, is Nozick at his absolutely, absolutely best. And if someone asks, but taxation is not the same as using coercion, let's say, in the bedroom, Nozick says, think again. So he says, taxation of earnings from labor is on par with forced labor. Some persons find this claim obviously true. Taking the earnings of an hour's labor is like taking N hours from the person. It is like forcing the person to work N hours for another's purpose. Others find the claim absurd. But even this, if they object to forced labor, would oppose forcing, for example, unemployed hippies to work for the benefit of the needy. And they would also object to forcing each person to work 5 extra hours each week for the benefit of the needy. So he says, look, you wouldn't take someone and take them to the fields and tell them you have to work because other people need it. So Nozick says, then why do you tell Jonathan that 3 hours of your day's work need to go to the needy? So that's why he says that taxation is in a way equivalent to forced labor, because it takes some of your hours every day and redirects them to a purpose that you have not chosen. And he answers also some other good objections. So
I'll just say one thing. It reminds me a little bit of a quote Don Watkins has said in the past that I like, where he says, you know, if I go and break into your house and steal your TV set, is that okay? People say, no. Well, is it okay if everyone votes on it? You know, and says, and it's not, it's still not okay. So even if the majority votes on it, it's still not okay. It's objectively wrong to violate others' rights. I don't know if you see a connection there or not.
And then,
by the way, I'm sorry, make thank you, Mark, for the donation through the super chat, Mark Choupe. I'll give you a thumbs up right back. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So this also shows the power of concretization. Why it's important when we go out to people as activists, as intellectual activists, we don't just throw them the party line of theory. We need to put some examples in the context of their own life. We need to concretize. So Pikoff says, every abstraction you give is like an IOU. It has to be paid with a concretization. And I will finish with perhaps my favorite thought experiment of Nozick, which has to do with him trying to discredit the idea that, maybe we shouldn't have equality of outcomes, but we should have equality of opportunity. And he says, look, what do you mean equality of opportunity? Because he says there are two ways to attempt to provide such equality: by directly worsening the situations of those more favored with opportunity, or by improving the situation of those less well favored. The latter requires the use of resources, and so it too involves worsening the situation of some, those from whom holdings are taken in order to improve the situation of others. So this is the reply to timid liberals, with the classical liberals sense, who say, we are not in favor of outcome of opportunity, but we need to make sure equality of opportunities. Therefore, give me your money so that I improve better, I don't know, infrastructure, schools, whatever. And here is what Nozick says. He gives a couple of thought experiments that, again, I want to mention. If the woman who later became my wife rejected another suitor whom she otherwise would have married for me, partially because of my keen intelligence and good looks, neither of which did I earn, parenthesis, I don't agree with this, but anyway, would the rejected less intelligent and less handsome suitor have a legitimate complaint about unfairness? So Nozick basically says, look, there is unfairness by facts that you have not chosen. And here he's winking at Rawls, obviously. It's unfair that you were born in, quote, obviously, unfair that you were born in a richer family. It was, quote, unfair that LeBron James has this body that makes him the most unbelievable athlete we've seen in basketball. But what does this mean? You have to actually punish LeBron? And then he goes on to slay another dragon, which needs to be slayed, which is this idea that, okay, you freedom-loving people, but you forget something. You forget that your freedom makes me worse off. So we hear this quite often with Uber, for example. They say that Uber, yeah, maybe it's good for the customer and good for the driver, but what about the taxi driver? Or it's okay.
Let me get out the world's smallest violin for those smelly, stinky, monopolistic taxi driver. And I'll just say one thing, interrupt really briefly, Nikos. I mean, this, I love this discussion of equality. Dr. Brooke and obviously Don Watkins have done a lot on this. And you know, Yaron always makes the point, I like that, there is only one type of equality, and that is equality under the law. And if you have equality under the law, you know, everything else is, you know, the fact that LeBron James is born, you know, physically great for basketball is a metaphysical fact. It's not a choice. It's just a fact of reality. And thank you, Christopher, for your contribution. I'm going to mimic the cool dude. And thank you, Marilyn, who Nico says that you're number one. According to Marilyn, you're number one. And I agree with Marilyn. Thank you both.
Thank you so much. Marilyn, thank you very, very much.
Yes.
So here comes the example then of, by the way, the fact that LeBron has been gifted with his body doesn't mean that he didn't have to put thousands of hours of work.
Of course, so there's a lot of very tall, of course. Yeah,
yeah, that's something else that the egalitarians forget. So anyway, we're back to this idea that, oh, but your freedom makes me worse off. And Nozick gives another thought experiment. I will very much simplify it. Let's say there is me, Jonathan, and let's say two women. Joanna and Maria. I want Joanna is my first choice, but also Jonathan's first choice is Joanna. Second choice for me and you is Maria. So,
well, maybe we can work something out where, like, you know, I'm just saying there's other options that.
Nah, it's not really my taste. No, no. More than two people is too much. So he says, look, if Joanna picks Jonathan, then I end up with Maria. But does it mean that then my choice is not voluntary? So why does, this is an argument to many socialists who say, oh, me having capitalism is actually oppressing me because I have to go to work. And because everyone else is rich, this puts a pressure on me. And therefore me going to work is involuntary. And he says, no. You can have an act which is not your first choice. So you would have preferred to sit all day singing poems to the sun. But the fact that due to the society you live, you have to work, does not mean that this is oppressing you. In the same way that if your first romantic option, Joanna, is taken and you, Jonathan, end up with Maria, this does not mean that your choice is not voluntary. It is that now reality is that you cannot have Joanna, so you choose Maria. The fact that in an ideal world you'd have Joanna does not mean that your choice is not voluntary. And speaking about couplings and stuff, he has another brilliant example. But yeah, go on.
Oh, just quickly, you know, Dr. Peikoff in one of his podcasts is asked a lot about relationships. He makes the point basically that when you realize that Joanna doesn't want you, basically when you accept that, you don't want Joanna. And I'm paraphrasing completely, but go back and look, you know, meaning that, you know, when you see that Joanna doesn't want you, she wants someone else, when you accept that, and I'm paraphrasing, of course, your view will turn to Maria or someone else. Thank you, Charlie Sama. You know, Nikos, he sent us a happy little fox who's thanking us. So let's thank him. You're keeping the lights on here at the Ayn Rand Center UK. Thank you so much.
Thank you very, very much. And I'll finish with another example, which basically makes the same choice, that the same point, that someone might do something that you don't like it, but if that person has not violated your rights, and if what that person has done is, again, a voluntary deal with someone else, then if you don't like it, tough luck. So, and again, how many times we've seen saying, this should be banned. Why? Because I don't like it. Like the religious conservatives used to do it. Now, of course, the left does it all the time. And again, another brilliant example, in my opinion, brilliant from Nozick. If four people propose marriage to a woman, her decision about whom, if any of them, to marry, importantly affects each of the lives of those four persons, her own lives and the lives of any other persons wishing to marry one of these four men, and so on. Would anyone propose even limiting the group to include only the primary parties that all five persons vote to decide who she shall marry? So could we take away the choice of a woman to choose her husband because her choice will affect other people? So again, to put it into politics, if you choose not to contribute, let's say, to a cause, that's the fact that the other people need you to contribute to that choice, the same way as the three other suitors want to marry that girl. Does it mean that they have a say on your life? And Nozick says, obviously not. Equally, they shouldn't have a say on your life, Jonathan, and on what you do with your time, your body, and your money. So this is Nozick's argument. Again, in my view, brilliant concretizations of these principles. And the book is full of these. And then he goes on to part three, which is, he calls it a framework for utopia, where he basically says, leave people alone to build their own voluntary communities. If you want to join a socialist one, join a socialist one, but allow us to have our own free society. Now, this is really nuanced. There are very, very potential problems with that. For example, if our neighborhood wants Sharia law, which would include technically, yeah, everyone says, yeah, we voluntarily agree that. But then if then it violates people's rights, is that okay? So this opens a huge discussion. Now,
yeah, that's the whole point. It's the competing police forces that are going to decide what the rights are. This is why anarchy just falls apart immediately. But, you know, I mean, I'll give it a hearing. But, you know, the whole point, you know, when you're reading Nozick, read Rand's, in my opinion, Man's Rights and the Nature of Government. They're short, unlike that book, no offense, and they just spell it out. So they build on those fundamentals you talked about, Nico. So I just have to throw that out a little bit as well.
Yeah. Again, Nozick is a quote minarchist. He's not in support of anarchy, but he takes anarchy almost as a metaphysical state where we find ourselves in. But anyway, that's another thing. By the way, this was not...
Oh, and thank you. I'm so sorry. Mary Lynn gave us an ice cream cone. Thank you so much for your continued contributions to the Ayn Rand Center UK. Much
thank
appreciated.
Thank you very much, Mary Lynn. We really appreciate it. Now, just to clarify something, this was just a short introduction so that people who might be interested can jump in. Also, we alluded to some of the differences between Nozick and Rand. For people who want to understand the differences between Nozick and Rand, there's this excellent volume, edited book, Foundation of a Free Society, Reflections on Ayn Rand's Political Philosophy, edited by Greg Salmieri and Robert Nozick. Now, this book, which is basically includes also some dialogues with some libertarians, it has at least two chapters where specifically they are referred to Nozick, two chapters. The one is Ayn Rand and Robert Nozick on Rights by Lester Hunt, and the other is by Onkar Gatte, Rand contra Nozick on Individual Rights and the Emergence and Justification of Government. So if you want to understand how, as we said, Nozick is very, very good in concretizing, but he's not as good as a system builder, as a philosophical system builder. If you want to understand the issues with Nozick, either, you know, read the whole book and judge for yourself. That should be the first part. Second part, you can also check the relevant chapters here. Again, hopefully we've given you a general understanding about what this is about, and you can, you know, you can make your own mind. So Lord Emperor says something. Okay, so
he says join us at Clubhouse. We'll see you there.
He says join us at Clubhouse, but one more thing. So today we have the premiere of a new show for the Ayn Rand Center UK. It's with Seth Levin, and it's called The Integrating Investor. So for people who thought, look, you people talk about politics, philosophy, romance, all the current affairs. Now we are also talking about investing. So Seth is going to have his own show every Friday, 8 o'clock UK time. Tune in. And as you said, join us on Clubhouse in a couple of minutes if you want to continue the discussion about Nozick. There's more stuff in Anarchy State in Utopia, more stuff about the good and about the not so good with Nozick. So we're going to see you there. Many thanks, Jonathan. Many thanks to our viewers. Many thanks to those who share, like, engage with us. That's very important, and that's how we continue doing that. Okay, off to Clubhouse. Have a great weekend. Bye, everyone.